Hello and welcome to Bonus. It is, after all, the end of February, and I did kind of promise to try and keep these things monthly. So here we are. We're playing some Battlefield 1. Why Battlefield 1? Because I needed some gameplay, and I don't know, it kind of came down to a choice between Infinite Warfare, Titanfall 2, or Battlefield 1. And I've got to be honest with you, I'm pretty bad at playing Titanfall 2, because I really don't have many hours in it. Whereas Battlefield 1, yeah, I am pretty bad, because I'm out of practice on FPS games. But I'm okay, I can play Battlefield passably, at least. Anyway, I'm not here to wow you with the quality of my gameplay, I am in fact here to answer questions. An XD meme says, Stu, for Retrohoy, I have some suggestions. Metal Gear Solid or Zelda. They are old games with large impact on gaming. You could also do something about 90 CRPGs like Fallout, Baldur's Gate, Diablo, etc. All of these are perfectly fine suggestions. In fact, there are, let's be honest here, quite a lot of Retrohoys I could do. It's a question of narrowing it down to games that I want to do. Retrohoy is going to return quite soon. I have two more iconic arms left to do. There's the rocket launcher, then there's the P90, which is the last one in the season. Then I plan to do a special, which is a retro special, but it's not a Retrohoy. It's slightly different. But anyway, after that special, I'm pretty sure Retrohoy will be returning, but I'm not sure with what game. Whatever, I've got a list of things that I'd like to do. It's in my head. What is it? So I've mentioned Outrun as a potential candidate. Also XCOM, I'd like to do one of that, or UFO Enemy Unknown, as I originally knew it. And also The Secret of Monkey Island, that's another potential. I want to do something which isn't an FPS, because I've done a lot of FPS games for Retrohoy. Well, I've done the three id ones, and I'd like to do something which isn't an FPS game, just to remind people that there are other genres of games, and not to paint myself into this sort of weird FPS corner. Which is why I'm quite eager to get off Iconic Arms onto something more interesting. But yeah, Retrohoy will be a regular feature on my channel, I feel. I think the long-form documentaries that are, you know, offer a comprehensive view on a particular game or franchise, they do go down pretty well. So yeah, big games like Metal Gear Solid, Zelda, yeah, it's not out of the question. I mean, to be honest, back in the 90s I was more of a PC gamer, so console games I have less affinity for. But like you say, I can't deny their impact, or the fact that they are, well, they are big games. So, one day, perhaps. I ain't choosing no damn real name YouTube says, any chance for a video on the newer Doom game? Played it over Christmas, soundtrack and gameplay made me fall in love. Curious as to your opinions on it, and if you've had a chance to have a good crack at it. Yes, I have played it. I bought it on release, and I played it. I somehow managed to find about 6 hours on the campaign, maybe slightly longer. I somehow managed to finish it. I've played the whole thing. And yeah, it was pretty good. I liked it. I mean, obviously, bearing the Doom name, which is, that's one heck of a legacy. And I don't think it was perfect by any means, but it was thoroughly enjoyable. I'll give it that much. For me, it was a solid 8 out of 10. The combat flow was nice, but I can't honestly say with a straight face that I enjoyed the bridge section, for instance. And in fact, any of the platforming I thought was a little bit weak. You know, the floating platforms when you get to hell. I don't know. Just for me, falling to your death in Doom and then suffering a load screen, that was never what Doom was about for me. But, you know, apart from that, I can't fault the combat. It was fun, exciting, and the glory kills, yeah, they are a little bit cinematic. But they were fun. AST5515 says, many YouTubers have been experiencing issues with their subscribers not receiving notifications from their uploads. How do you think this is going to affect you given your upload schedule, in air quotes? I think the problems with notifications are often overstated by YouTubers. I think that's fair to say. I don't really mind. I mean, my channel's right there. If people want to watch my videos, they know where they are. And yeah, alright, so there are some oddities with YouTube's system, but it kind of works most of the time. And in the case of my channel, I mean, honestly, you can get away with checking maybe once a month. You know, it's not like you're going to miss a lot if you don't if you don't follow your subscriptions, you're not going to miss hundreds of videos, are you? You know, just check once or twice a year and you'll be fine. Burton says, will you make more beer videos in the future? The answer is yes, probably. But I need to be struck with inspiration first. And I don't know, I don't have any good ideas for Drinks Ahoy. But the channel is, I consider it kind of an occasional project. When I feel the need to make a video about beer or some aspect of alcohol, I will. But until then, I don't know. We are losing objective button. Metroid U7 says, have you seen the Grand Tour yet? If you have, what do you think of it? I have, yes. I was watching the episodes as they came out. I quite enjoy Top Gear and the trio. So yeah, it's entertainment, isn't it? The first season, I think, obviously, you know, they were finding their footing a little bit. But there were some fun moments, and hopefully the format will be a little bit more refined for season two. Song in Silence says, it is always nice to hear that your family is doing well. Has the young Master Ahoy gotten the hang of any words yet? At the moment, he's kind of at the stage of uttering sounds with meaning rather than words. I think he's on the cusp of speaking, but I think boys tend to be a little bit sort of slower in talking as compared to girls, and I don't know, I think he's not slow, he's a miracle on the shape sort, and he's brilliant at that, but talking, he kind of does this weird, he has mock conversations, or he makes noises that sound like talking, but well, I can assure you he's not making much sense. Mr. Rightsab says, I see your first Patreon goals to help upgrade your PC. So, did you get around to getting a new build? If so, what are the new specs? I did, in fact. Yes, I got a new PC. Specs. It's nice, I can tell you that much. I can run PC games much, much better than the old one. The old one, I had, the Intel i5-2500K, which was a great chip, but it was starting to show its age. So, my specs, where are they? It's nothing outrageous, but it's a pretty solid build. What have we got? We've got the Intel Core i7-6700 at 3.4 GHz, which is, you know, it's nice. 16 gig RAM. I've got the Asus Tech H170 Pro Gaming Motherboard. My graphics card. There it is. 4 GB NVIDIA GeForce GTX 1070 from Asus. I spent quite a bit on hard drives, actually. Hard drive space is always a nice thing to have when video editing. So I've got a terabyte SSD for the system and applications. I've got 4 TB, a dedicated drive for games. I've got 6 TB, a dedicated drive for recordings and video game footage. And that's on top of my 10 TB drive for it's a Drobo. It's redundant. And that's where my work goes, my, you know, graphics and stuff like that, all the backups. So that's the new PC. I also bought myself a new 144Hz monitor, which was that's a nice upgrade. I don't think I could go back to a lower refresh rate now, to be honest. And I've got a triple screen setup now. I've got my two original 30-inch Dell monitors, the 3007s, on either side, and then I've got what is it? It's an Asus MG278. It's a 27-inch monitor, 144Hz, and it's 2560 by 1440. It's a nice monitor, pretty good for gaming, and I've got the grunt to play. On older games, certainly, I can hit at 1440p, I can hit 144Hz, which is nice. Not just about the games, of course. Obviously, video editing's smoother and faster, which is, that's nice as well, although, you know, there's no limit to the amount of power that would be nice when it comes to stuff like that. Jordan Griffith says, Iconic Arms for me is actually one of my favourite series on YouTube. Is there any chance of Season 4 on Iconic Arms? Yes, after I finish the run with the P90, that'll be Season 3, Iconic Arms will definitely return. However, in the future, I think I might move away from doing 6 episodes at a time. What I might do is I might do Season 4 in 2 parts of 3 episodes. Just because I don't like devoting my channel to firearms for an extended period of time, because a lot of people are turned off by firearms, and I don't want to turn away people who are interested in the video game side of things. So I'm probably going to dilute the long runs of Iconic Arms, but I plan on doing probably, well, I don't know how many seasons, but in terms of episodes, we're probably looking at between 30 and 40 episodes. That's my target for Iconic Arms, and I think once I hit 30 episodes, at that point, I'll probably start winding it down to, like, one-offs. You know, now and again, I'll do an Iconic Arms if there's something that takes my fancy. But, I mean, we've only done, 17 episodes so far, so we've got a couple of seasons runs left yet. Games for Days says, Stu, since you've expressed an interest in Forza and Dirt, have you played the Gran Turismo series? And are you interested at all in Gran Turismo Sport? Yes, very much so. I mean, I probably consider myself more of a fan of the Forza series. But there's room enough for more than one franchise in my heart, and I'd definitely consider getting Gran Turismo Sport when it came out. If it ever comes out. That's the trouble, isn't it? You've got to... I can't believe they haven't got a Gran Turismo game on the PS4 yet. Quite frankly, it baffles me. It baffles me that they haven't done one. Testroyer says, a Nord lead? Neat. Thinking of any drum machines to potentially go with it? Or are you just going to go with some samples and Reason? You know, I do like a drum machine. I'd love like a TR-808 or something like that. Even a 909. And I think Roland have issued remade versions of these classic drum machines. And I've been tempted. I'm not going to lie. I've been tempted. But I think for my next soundtrack project, for the special that's coming up, I'm probably just going to stick to Reason's beats. Because, yeah, there's a pretty wide variety of samples in there. And I can produce something that sounds, you know, pretty good. I'm happy enough with it anyway. But I'm definitely looking forward to taking the Nord lead for a proper test run with this new project. Because Iconic Arms, obviously all the music's already written. Jason says, have you ever been burned out on video games? I think, like everything, an interest like that waxes and wanes. But I don't think that there's ever been an extended period of time where I haven't played a game. I suppose sometimes, though, I have lost interest in kind of contemporary gaming. You know, I there was a time when I was at university, when I just started working. This is around 2002, 2004, 2005. I wasn't really that interested in keeping up with gaming. I didn't have a PS2. I was exclusively a PC gamer at this point. And I think, honestly, I just played classic games that I liked. I played Civilization a lot. I played a bunch of classic FPS games, you know, Unreal Tournament, stuff like that. I think, you know, one of the main reasons for this is that when I was a student, I had a lack of money, and when I started working, I had a lack of time. So, eventually, around 2006, when I had money and I had a little bit more time, I started to get back into it, and I eventually bought an Xbox 360, which was a catalyst for rekindling my interest in contemporary games, which eventually, of course, led to me starting a YouTube channel. But yeah, I mean, there are other things in life than video games, and sometimes they do take a priority, and they can sort of take a back seat slightly. But for me, you know, it's something I always come back to. I think even if they never released another video game ever again and everybody else stopped playing them, I'd probably still fire up Civilization every now and again. Gerardo Contreras says, what are your thoughts on the Nintendo Switch? I don't know. I haven't pre-ordered one, I'll say that much. There's not really much for me, I feel. I guess the hardware's kind of neat, you know, the fact that it's a hybrid handheld console, I guess. But I own a Nintendo Wii U, and I don't know. I guess I've kind of been burned by that a little bit. Because there just isn't really any support for it. Then there are a few cool games, but I mean it when I say a few. What really bugs me is Nintendo are sitting on a gold mine of classic games, and if they leverage that properly, they could really make an attractive value proposition. I mean, imagine like Netflix, but instead of films and TV, it was classic Nintendo games. I mean, I would pay a subscription fee for something like that. If you had sort of, you know, Nintendo games on demand, even if it was older ones, just from the NES, Super NES era, that would be cool. And if they built something like that into the Switch, and if they had decent software support and a nice library of games, I think they could make a success of it. But as of this moment, the system doesn't have a lot going for it. But maybe that will change. We'll see. Muffinland says, Stu likes cars. What kind of stuff have you owned? Now, I've got to be honest, my car history is not exactly spectacular. Yeah, you've got to understand, I'm a recent learner. I only learned last year, in fact. And I've been driving since about October of 2016. Which means I've only ever owned one car, and it's my mum's old car, which you know, she very kindly gave to me. Anyway, the point is, I drive a Nissan Micra, and that is my entire car history. It's not what I would have chosen, but I'll hold off in getting a cool car until my insurance costs come down a bit. Model Omega says, did you see my post on your subreddit about the showing of nuclear fruit in one of my university classes last semester? Any thoughts? I guess it's kind of weird. You know, it happens semi-frequently. Somebody will tell me that they saw my brief history of graphics normally in their university or college class. And it's like, okay, that's weird. I guess it's kind of flattering. I wonder if there's any money in doing educational videos. Probably not. Joe Rodriguez says, do you have another job too, Stu? Only if you count childcare. I spend a couple of days a week looking after the boy. So I've got, well, 3 or 4 days a week to work. It's just that, you know, obviously my videos requiring scripts and editing and all of that, they do take quite a lot of time. It's only since having a kid that I realised just how many hours I used to work on videos. I mean, we're talking, you know, I'd work pretty much every opportunity I had. And yeah, I mean, sure, sometimes I'd take some time off, I'd play video games, but, you know, it wasn't unusual for me to spend 60, 70 hours a week. So now that I've got restrictions on my time, now that I can't spend every waking hour working, you know, I kind of... It's taught me in some ways to be more efficient, which is a good thing. But, yeah, I mean, I get about 30 hours a week, maybe 40 hours some weeks. Halfway there, the enemy has the upper hand. Dr. Gonzo says, Stu, are you interested in the rumoured third Metro game coming out later this year? And are you a fan of the Metro series? Yes, I do like the Metro series. A fantastic atmosphere, wonderful, wonderful setting. If ever there was a game series that was calling out to not be a linear FPS, Metro was one of them, definitely. I don't know. I'd love a third game to come out. I would buy that in a heartbeat, but I don't know. It's all speculation and rumours at the minute, so I'm not going to get my hopes up. But yeah, I'd definitely pick that up. Mon Anniversa says, are you going to pressure your son into something? Do you have any expectations from him once he grows up? Well, it depends what you mean by pressure, you know, because, I mean, if you mean any sort of influence at all, then I think it's impossible to be a parent and not have an influence on your child. So I think it's probably fair to say that, you know, he's probably going to be interested in what I do for a living, he's probably going to find out about video games at some point, and that might shape his, you know, that might shape his interests. He might end up being into video games, or he might reject them and go his own way, and that's, I guess that's fine. Obviously, you know, it'd be nice if we had something in common. And, you know, maybe it'll be something that we do together as he's growing up, you know. And if he does express an interest, I'll probably try and nurture it. Because, you know, it's probably a healthy thing to do, isn't it? Probably. I don't know. There are no right and wrong answers when it comes to this sort of thing. But, I mean, if he, you know, if he did tell me, oh, I don't want to play video games, Dad, I want to do arithmetic, I'd probably support him. Everloyal Eagle says, do you think supply drops is a good thing or bad thing for Call of Duty ever since they were introduced in Advanced Warfare? It's probably a good thing for Call of Duty's bottom line, and it might be a way that they eke out longer profitability from the series, which, if you like, the Call of Duty games might be indirectly a good thing, but I think in terms of gameplay balance and stuff like that, and just general, I don't know, I don't like them. I don't think many people really do. Now I'm kind of, in a sense, I'm glad I don't really play Call of Duty anymore because of it. But, I don't know, I'm sure there must be some people out there who enjoy them, you know. I like the idea of having rare things in COD, you know, something that you can work towards. But when you introduce the real money aspect, I'm less sure that's a good thing. So, good thing for Activision, bad thing for everyone else. But, you know, hey, that's business. John Gallagher says, do you use peripherals for driving games? I love the idea, but haven't committed. Any suggestions? What do I use? I use the Logitech Driving Force GT920, which is compatible with both the Xbox One and PC. I've got the shifter for it as well, and I have that attached to a Wheelstand Pro, which is, it's like a folding adjustable stand. It's quite minimal, but relatively sturdy, and it works. Yeah, it works pretty well. I think for my budget, it was probably about right, but I think you can get better. I think the Fanatec stuff, that's probably top tier. And if you have the space for it, I think a full driving seat with mounts is probably the better option. But, you know, that's a pretty serious commitment. What I tend to find is I play with the wheel and pedals for the first couple of weeks of a new game's release, and then I'll kind of go back to a controller just for casual play. Drunk Cat says, have you ever thought of doing collaborations with other educational channels? I'm all for collaboration, but you've got to have an idea of how things are going to work. So I think it's project dependent. The special that I'm thinking of doing, I'm actually thinking about looking for not really collaboration, but input from some other YouTubers. I have a couple of goals for this video. One of them is the inclusion of interviews or, you know, sound bites, stuff like that, because that's something I'd like to do more. I think it'd be quite a nice contribution to stuff like RetroHoy. So that's something I'm looking to sort of work out the logistics of. Another goal is to do some deeper analysis, to sort of really drill in, because sometimes I'm accused of, you know, being superficial. Now, there's nothing fundamentally wrong with being superficial. For instance, in a video like A Brief History of Graphics, you have to be superficial. But I wanted to do something which could really sort of, you know, I want to go deep rather than wide on this video. So I've got a relatively narrow scope for the video. It's on a very specific subject. And there is going to be some pretty deep analysis, just so I can't be accused of just reading Wikipedia.
Yeah.
I think that's probably something that a lot of informative YouTubers get levied at them. And it's almost invariably not true. I wish I could just read Wikipedia articles. That would be easy. But, obviously, there's a bit more thought that goes into my scripts than that. But this special, I'm looking to bring in original research. I'm looking to have, you know, original first-hand interviews and material like that. So it's quite ambitious, but I think it should be cool. Because, well, at the very least, there's going to be some cool graphics, and I'm going to write a full soundtrack for it. And I've got some neat ideas. Joe McLaughlin says, last bonus was 5 months ago, then 1 year, the second last one. Unacceptable! Get a real job! You have a kid! YouTube is a sinking ship. Cheers. We're all sinking ships, and the sooner you realise that, the sooner you can ride the wave. Anyway, on that bombshell, I shall bid you farewell. Thank you very much for watching, and until next time, farewell.